You murderers! There's not only beer in that keg. There's beer and blood. Blood of men.
I was about 10 years old, and Warner Brothers released on a double bill a reissue of Little Caesar and Public Enemy. And my father took me to see them. And I think seeing these particular films on a big screen, the impact of them was very, very strong. And I think it stayed with me for many, many years.
The authors of the original story for Public Enemy were two guys from Chicago named Kubrick Glassman and John Bright. And it was based upon their novel called Beer and Blood, and a number of scenes in the film are drawn from actual gangland events.
And so the violence and, if you will, arrogance of the characters in the early Warners is made possible by the underlying reality, the fact that the viewers knew these people were real.
Glassman and Bright, as longtime friends and growing up in Chicago, does relate to the opening of the film in a way in which the kind of history of the saloon and of the Chicago community is spelled out in a montage sequence. And so then you see Matt and Tom as boys and their relationship to the saloon. They emerge as adults. There was a kind of documentary aspect to these films. Little Caesar, Doorway to Hell, Public Enemy.
Probably of all these pictures, Public Enemy is the toughest in terms of its depiction of that world, the honesty of the way people behave in that world, the nature of what a young killer really is.
It'll hold six.
Oh, this'll be enough. Stick 'em up. Stick 'em up.
There are many legends about casting Public Enemy. Zanuck tells his version, Wellman tells his version, Glassman and Bright tell their version. What seems to have happened? They definitely cast Wood as Tom and Cagney as Matt. And then about 2 weeks before the film was scheduled to start, Cagney suddenly was put into a film called The Millionaire with George Arliss.
Hey, you'll excuse me crashing the gates, but I saw you in the garden. You're Mr. Alden, ain't you, with the Alden Motor Car.
Cagney comes in as an insurance salesman, and he's definitely the New York lingo guy.
If I was a man like you, you know what I would do?
Know what?
Well, I'll tell you.
Well, Mr. Bones, if you were a man like me, what would you do, Mr. Bones?
I wouldn't sit around and wait for the undertaker. Did you ever read the business chances in the newspaper?
Business chances? Can't say I have.
Well, here we are. Three columns of them. For sale. Best paying barbershop in town. Be a butcher, going concern. No, half innocent busy beauty parlor. Lay off the busy beauties.
He happened to walk away with that picture. He wasn't the star of the movie, he was a support. Well, when a support walks away with a movie, you're going to build a picture around him. You're going to build a campaign. You're going to put him in a star vehicle.
Wellman realized that the guy he's going to have to go with is Cagney, and they reversed the roles, and that was it.
Cagney really brought the sense of the street.
Hey, Stoke, that's got gears. That ain't no Ford.
Okay, boss.
He had a kind of sociological realism as a performer that he attributed to his life experience growing up in the city streets.
When Dutch comes around, he's going to leave you some beer, and you're going to take it, and you're going to kick him with the dough. If you don't, somebody's going to drop by here and kick your teeth out one at a time. Get me!
That guy, it's very interesting because also the pace of that kind of dialogue is deceptive because around 1930, 31, they were told to speak slowly and articulately for the camera, for the microphone. There was only one. So you get a strange kind of surreal kind of stretching out of words by some people. But Cagney didn't pay attention to any of that. He just did what he had to do.
I'm going to give her that putty nose right in the head the first time I see him.
Yeah.
You and who else?
There's something special when he walks on the screen that you know that suddenly a command that he has and takes over the picture in a way. And has such confidence. And also has a lot to do with the way he moves his body language. You see this evident throughout the entire picture of Public Enemy in little moments all the way through.
He had a kind of repeated gesture. They called it a short arm jab, where he would go up to somebody and kind of give him a little double punch, soft punch. It happens all the time in the film. And even his mother does it to him at one point. And Cagney is just doing little skip steps and body motion. And it worked. He was a bundle of energy.
Certainly in the scene where he meets Jean Harlow and he takes her for a ride in his car, and he gets out of the car and she says goodbye and see you later. And before he gets back into the car, he does a two or three step turn, and I don't know why, some sort of dance step, but it works.
You could go for an 80-year-old chick with rheumatism.
When are you going to see her?
She's going to call me. Find out if she's got a friend.
Public Enemy was one of Jean Harlow's first major roles. She had been in Hell's Angels, the Howard Hughes film. He had her contract. Warner Brothers borrowed her from Hughes's company, Caddo, for the film, which was an extravagance for Warner Brothers.
What made Harlow at MGM, of course they don't use this here, is that heavenly look, you know, the platinum blonde, the silky gowns.
Harlow brings kind of inimitable quality to the role. It's very striking.
And she talks like someone from South Bronx. I mean, that was the funny thing about Jean Harlow.
I'll think it over. Give me your phone number and I'll call you.
It's some of the most strange line readings in with her in this film.
I may leave town next week. You don't care, do you?
I think I better call it quits.
Oh, don't be like that, Tommy. Of course I go for you, as you say.
She was still on the way, because I think in a year later or something, she was really on. But she has the presence. She has the presence. And there's that strange speech when she sits on Tom Power's lap and talks to him about the kind of man he is, the kind of boy he is.
Oh, my bashful boy. You are different, Tommy. Very different.
And it's beautifully done. At first, the tone of it bothers me. It sounds like it's not quite well done. But she has a presence that's beyond acting, that is on the screen, something that has to be reckoned with, you know.
Public Enemy is significant both for the arrival of a great acting talent and a great directorial talent.
William Wellman was one of Warner's contract directors in this period. He was a very good action director. He was working a lot in those days, you know, making four or five films a year.
He was in the Lafayette Escadrille, the flying World War I planes. He got in a plane accident, I believe the stick that you use to fly the plane, I don't know, whatever, you know, those little, went through the bottom of his neck here into his palate, and was known as Wild Bill, and was known as a ferocious fighter for what he believed in and the kind of films he wanted to make.
Jack Warner was always cracking the whip. He wanted a certain number of minutes shot every day and so on. So the range of what a director could do may have been fairly limited.
But I find it very interesting. As tough as it is, there's an elegance to the photography, to the way he sets up scenes. There's an elegance to the scene, for example, in which Tom and his friend Matt Doyle go and they do the job for Putty Nose in the fur warehouse and they have to shoot a cop. And there's an extraordinary shot, a very elegant shot of the cop, just his arm on the ground with the gun in his hand. And it's gleaming. It looks like something out of a silent film.
William Wellman really makes that film work. Moving camera, the angles he chooses, the placement of the characters within the angles he chooses. It works so well. It's really a very well-directed film with a great performance in it and a very powerful story.
This is real street stuff, I think, and particularly the ending. And I think the story is known that they didn't want to have him do that ending, and he fought to get the ending, Wellman, which is a very strong ending and a very truthful ending. And it was an even more moral ending, I think.
I think any viewer going to these movies will understand that these characters are somewhat pitiful. A lot of them are constrained by their environments into behaving in a violent way because it's the only answer that they feel society has given to them. But I think what these movies say is you have to find an alternative, because if you don't, you will end up dead, and it won't be a pretty end.
Ain't you got a drink in the house?
Well, not before breakfast, dear.
I didn't ask you for any lip. I asked you if you had a drink.
The most notorious scene in the film is the so-called grapefruit scene. Tom Powers is living with Kitty, his girlfriend, who's played by Mae Clark.
I don't know whether it's an improvisation or not, but that extraordinary scene of him sitting at the breakfast table.
I wish you was a wishing well, so that I could tie a bucket to you and sink you.
Maybe you found someone you like better.
He picks up the grapefruit and smashes it in her face. Again, that's a brutality and a crudity that really shocks the audience, especially at that time. Now, these days, it's a different thing, but one didn't expect to see that for a long period of time in Hollywood, classical Hollywood cinema. You didn't get that sort of thing.
Warner Brothers' legend was he was only supposed to simulate or pretend that he was going to do it or to give it to her just a certain way, threaten her. That's what he was supposed to do. And of course, when he did it, it shocked. And then it was brought the house down in places. I mean, even reviewers.
It's based on an incident in Chicago gangland, where one of the gangsters supposedly shoved an omelet into the face of his girlfriend.
Next year, when they teamed Mae Clark and Cagney together in Lady Killer, he's got one that even does better than the grapefruit. He takes her by her hair and drags her across two hotel rooms into the corridor. This is amazing.
And there's something about Cagney in the picture where he just lets it go. He doesn't care. He gives himself to the character. Good, bad, indifferent. He just does it.
That ain't our beer. Where'd you get the slops?
Well, it's good, ain't it? And it's cheaper than yours.
How much you pay for this stuff?
2 bits, Glad.
All right, screw.
In terms of the violence in a gangster picture, whether from Warner's or another studio, I think the expressive tradition in which they work goes back a long ways. They're no more grisly than, say, an Italian opera or Shakespeare play. I think the difference in movies is that you can add a level of realism.
Public Enemy is probably the most brutal of them all, in a way. And yet, you never see the violence. The violence is all off screen. It makes it worse.
Stay where you are.
One particular scene where they get their revenge on Putty Nose and he's playing the piano.
Tell me how long do I have to wait?
The camera tracks away from Putty Nose playing the piano, and as the camera tracks away, Edward Woods is not just standing there, though. He's not standing. He's moving towards the door, so he's in movement also. And you hear the gunshot.
I'll call up Gwen.
And then Cagney walks into frame and says, okay, let's go back to the place, you know, as if nothing affected him. And that's part of the animal that Cagney is, too, in the picture. Unlike other characters that he plays in Roaring Twenties and other, he really is almost like a psychopath in a way. He doesn't feel it for the people. He just doesn't. When Woods gets killed while they're hiding out, and Cagney goes for retribution, and again, the elegance of the photography, the heavy rainfall, the big climactic scene. He goes into a storefront. Camera does not go in with him. Doesn't go in with him. And camera stays outside. You hear gunshots and you hear a man scream. And then and Cagney stumbles out, holding two guns, like a Western almost, and leans against the door, and you hear more screaming and moaning. That, as a younger person watching that, was much more horrific than any of the bloodshed you could have shown. Now, you say, well, Morty, why haven't you done it in your films? Well, I don't make them that way, I guess, but I just can't. I really liked it as a kid, and I kept going to see it often different theaters. And before I knew it, I was more or less studying it, I guess. One of the key things that happened was that I found the score, the music score, very effective. And I didn't understand what it was for a while, but then I realized there's no music score. It's all source music. And the source becomes the score. The songs of the late teens and the early 20s and all the way through the early 30s, up to 1931, really, is the score, particularly a song called I'm Forever Blowing Bubbles, which is over the opening credits. And a kind of jaunty 1909 version. And then is played at the first point in which Cagney and his friend Matt Doyle walk into Putty Nose's place, and Putty Nose puts him up to a job.
Remember how I always said, when I got something good, I cut you in.
And as he's talking to the kids, it's the same song. And that song, of course, is used at the very end.
Don't you like your dinner?
What? I just ain't hungry, Ma.
The film ends, literally, with that song being played out. And as the body of Cagney, in a most brutal image, crashes to the floor, face down, bang, as his brother opens the door, and his brother just walks towards camera, almost like a zombie, and knowing that he has to tell his mother upstairs that he is home, that Tommy is home, but he's dead, and it's not gonna be a pretty sight. And it cuts to the record player, and the record is finished, and just keeps, the needle on the record keeps you know, going back and forth on the last section of the record. I was working on a picture called The Aviator, and it's about Howard Hughes in the early days, and particularly about, in the beginning of the film, shooting Hell's Angels, which is a film with Gene Harlow, et cetera. And I, as research, I showed the actors two films, Public Enemy and Wings. Now, Public Enemy was important because I wanted Leo DiCaprio to understand, as Howard Hughes, what Howard Hughes was up against, what he had to top when he came into town and made Scarface. That night we showed Public Enemy in 35 millimeter, a little screening room in Los Angeles, and there were some other young actors there, some people on the crew, and something happened. These are kids, I mean, mid-20s, some are early 20s. Cagney walks on the screen, and as one of them put it afterwards, modern screen acting begins. I must say that they reacted to everything in that picture as if it was a film that came out yesterday. And it still holds up, particularly if you see it on a big screen, holds up in terms of its ability to shock, but not shock in a gratuitous way. It's shocking about the truth of the world, the sordidness of the world that it's depicting. Ultimately, by the end of the picture, as soon as the end credits came up, there was spontaneous applause. And I said, my God, if William Wellman had been in this room now, 70 years later, to have seen this honest reaction.
That film pulls no punches, literally or figuratively. It's a masterpiece.